All right, in this video, we're going to be looking at BabyAGI again, but this time we're looking at an implementation done with LangChain. And I think it's kind of makes it quite a bit better in that you can see what's going on a bit easier, and you can also mess with it and experiment with it yourself. So here we've basically got the collab for doing this. Hopefully you've seen the video about BabyAGI already. You know what it is. In this case, we're going to be using OpenAI. And we're also, I'm doing the one here, which is actually BabyAGI with tools. So there are two versions. There is one where you're not doing any external calls, which is the same as what we looked at the other night. And this one basically is where you're doing a tool using a search engine to be able to make external calls as well with this. So to do that, we basically need to have OpenAI in here. And we also need to have a search engine API for the search engine chain that we're going to be running. You can see the version of LangChain that I've got going here. It's pretty standard compared to what we looked at last time. We're not using Pinecone. So we do have a vector store, which is the face vector store or the face vector store, but it's all in memory in this case. So we're not doing any external calls to Pinecone. It just makes it much easier. Now, if you wanted to, you could wire this up to Pinecone just by changing a few of these things. We're using the OpenAI embeddings for the embeddings of the vector store. And I realize I haven't done a lot of videos with vector stores, so I might do a few going forward just to explain some of these concepts more in depth, but I'm guessing a lot of people will know what they are. So that's the first thing, is just sort of your memory store that you're going to be using to reference. Then you've got the chains themselves. So this is where it's actually really nice to have LangChain, because we can actually see, okay, what are these chains doing? What are the prompts for them? That kind of thing. So we can see that, okay, we've got this task creation. We've got three main chains that we're going to be using here. I've put up the task creation, task prioritization, and then the execution. So you're going to give it an overall goal, and it's going to generate a bunch of tasks. So this first chain is going to be this task creation chain. We can see, looking at the prompt, right, it's basically saying you are a task creation AI that uses the result of an execution agent to create new tasks with the following objective. Now, that's where our objective will go in. The last completed task has the result, and then this is what's being generated from before this. And this result was based on this task description. This is the task description. And then these are incomplete tasks. So if it's got a list of tasks that hasn't done yet, this is where it will feed these in. So you can see we're actually feeding four different variables into the prompt here. Based on the result, create new tasks to be completed by the AI system that do not overlap with incomplete tasks. Return the tasks as an array. So this is our first sort of chain, and it's pretty simple to see how this works. And this is where you could come in and mess with this. So if you wanted to make something very custom that did a very specific kind of thing, you could come in here and change these and learn from how they've done it in here. Next up is task prioritization. You're a task prioritization AI, tasked with cleaning the formatting of and reprioritizing the following tasks. So it gets the tasks passed in there. Consider the ultimate objective of your team, objective here. Do not remove any tasks, return the result as a numbered list, like, and then it gives it a way to format it, and it gives us the next task. So this, again, very simple kind of chain. We can look at this, we can see what's going on. Now, for the no tools version, the execution would actually be very simple. So I've put this in here and just commented out. For the tools version, the execution is a little bit more complicated. So here we're basically defining an agent. So this is an executor agent. We're going to pass some tools into it. So first, let's just look at what the prompt for this is. You are a planner who is an expert at coming up with a to-do list for a given objective. Come up with a to-do list for this objective. And then you pass in the objective. And then it's got the actual tools for this. So we can see that the tools that we're going to pass in is search and a to-do. So search is useful when you need to answer questions about current events. Now, we could play around with this too and say current events or pricing or things that are, you know, could be found online. Tool, the to-do, useful for when you need to come up with a list of to-dos. And then it basically gives us a little bit of information about that. We can see there's a prefix and a suffix to this as well. And this basically is taking in the objective and some of the things that we've already put in there. And then finally, the question. And this is where we can put in our scratch pad for this. Now, this executor is not using a React one. It's actually just using a zero-shot agent here. You can see we're passing in the prompt, we're passing in the prefix, suffix, and the input variables. So hopefully when you look at this, if you've been looking at some of the other videos about LangChain, you'll see that, oh, okay, this is not that different than single things that we've done in the past. We're just now starting to wire a bunch of these things up together. We've now got some functions that basically just define running these things and set up the loop for this. So this is the key thing, is that we're not just running this thing once and saying, okay, you're done. We're basically making it go through a loop where it's going to basically prioritize tasks. It's going to get the next task. It's going to get top tasks, and then it's going to execute it all together. So this is what this code is doing here. It's basically just putting it all together in parts. Again, this is different if you were doing the no tools version. We're doing the tools version. So we can see here that we've got our task list. We've got the different chains going on for this. We're just basically making a class for BabyAGI in this. You can see that we can add a task. We can print a task list. We can print the next task. We can print a task result. So we've got a bunch of functions in here that the class will be able to use in conjunction with the language model to run this all together. And then we can see running the actual agent, we've got our while loop. This is not that different for something like AutoGPT or some of the other autonomous AI things. Basically, these things are on some kind of loop, whether usually that's going to be a while loop, where it's doing different things until it gets a certain result, and then it exits based on that. So here we can see the different things. Now, we're not storing it in Pinecone, we're just storing it locally, but we can see that, okay, that's what's going on there. We can see the creating new tasks and reprioritizing it. And one of the things that you could play around with this is, I actually think you could get a lot better results by having another separate chain which does some summarization of like a final report or something like that. You'll see that when we go through it, that while it's doing all the things, it's not great at coming to conclusions at the end for this. So then we basically just run this. And what I thought I would do is run it on the same thing that I ran the AutoGPT in the previous video, so that we could check out, you know, how well it does. So here the objective is find the cheapest price and site to buy a YubiKey 5C online and give me the URL. So I'm passing in the OpenAI language model. We're setting the temperature to zero. We're basically just instantiating this BabyAGI class here with the LLM. So we're passing in the LLM with the vector store. We can set a max number of iterations. So this is one of the things that's nicer about this version compared to the other version. In the previous video, it was just going on and on and on. Here, we're basically limiting it to 7 iterations and then stopping for that. And then we just basically kick it all off where we pass in the objective. So, okay, first off, it's going to make this to-do list. And it's going to say, okay, what do you need to do? So it's a to-do. I need to find the cheapest price and site to buy a YubiKey 5C online and give me the URL. All right. So the to-do list is research online retailers that sell YubiKey 5C, e.g. Amazon, Best Buy, etc. This is really good that it's done this. Compare prices across different retailers. Again, very good. Check for discounts or promotions available. Very good. I will say that it doesn't actually do all these things, but it's kind of cool that it's thinking of these things. And it could be that it didn't do all these things because I limited the number of iterations. That's quite possible too, actually. Read customer reviews for each retailer to determine the best site to buy from. Because all the stuff it's generating here is amazingly good, right? If this bot would work like this, this would be very useful to us. All right. And then it's basically going to get the cheapest price with the site and give us a URL. So it comes up with the different tasks. It starts doing some search. So you can see it does a search on prices of YubiKey across different online stores. Its observations are some of the places that it sees them and which YubiKeys it's seeing. It thought that, I need to find the cheapest one. So the search cheapest price and site to buy YubiKey online. observation is $50. So this is definitely in the ballpark. If you remember, just quickly looking at it, this is what we were trying to find yesterday. And AutoGPT did manage to find this price of $55 off Amazon. Looking back at this, we can see that, okay, basically it's going through this chain. It's basically making its tasks list. It's going through again. It's doing search for discount codes and promotions. I would say this is where maybe it starts to go off track actually a little bit. It gets some codes for this where it basically finds some different things. It goes back to its list of comparing different things and adding any other things that it needs to have here so that it comes out with the compare the prices of the YubiKey 5C across different online stores. And it's still kind of stuck on this thing, right? Of, again, it's finding the same kind of prices. It comes back, moves on to the identify and additional discounts or promotions available for the YubiKey. Here it's stuck again, looking for the promotions and stuff like that. Finally, it gets to something where it is giving us a URL. We can see that, like, just sort of fast forwarding through, it gives us a URL and it says the cheapest price and site to buy a YubiKey 5C online is $50 from YubiKey. So it gives us this URL. So this URL, products YubiKey hardware, when I click it, you can't see it, but actually this, it seems that URL doesn't exist. So we get to the products page and then under hardware, sure enough, there is the 5 series that we can look at, which is where we're at looking at this. But if we actually go into the store and scroll down, we can see that, okay, it does look like the 5C is $55, not $50. So it's definitely found us like the right area of the internet and that kind of thing. Hasn't been perfect at finding the actual item and giving us the right thing there. My guess is that it's semi-hallucinating parts of the URL, because if you look at this, the other thing also could be the actual location that I'm in. So as I'm recording this video, I'm currently in Australia. And so I do notice that they have a /AU in there. So it could be that where the Koala version is running in a US data center, I'm looking at it from another thing. But that said, when I tried this also with a VPN, it still didn't give me the exact one. Try it out yourself and find out. I thought I would then sort of test this out a little bit more. So I said, okay, find the YubiKey on Amazon and give me the URL. Long story short, it went through and it certainly found this URL. Again, this URL doesn't exist, right? When we click this URL, we get, sorry, couldn't find that page. Even though the details on the URL are pretty accurate and pretty similar to the real URL, it is slightly different. Right? So we might want to have another module in there that actually checks, does this URL exist, and look at it that way. So anyway, this is basically using it in LangChain. I definitely think this is worth studying and thinking about what you could use it for, how you could mess with the prompts, how you could change different elements of it. I will also give you the no tools version of it as well, so you can play around with that. Another thing that I tried out, because I'm getting a lot of questions, is could we do this with a model that's not OpenAI? So I thought, okay, let's try this with Koala. All right, so Koala is one of the models that we looked at last time. So here I'm basically bringing in the Koala model and setting up the Koala 7 billion model. And to do this with LangChain, we basically need to set up a pipeline. And I've set up a pipeline for text generation. I've set up some things with this. You could play around with these. I probably should have done that with a lower temperature. But the problem is not that. So the problem is that this model is not actually trained on this kind of thing. So in a future episode, I might actually train one of these models on to do this task so we could actually look at it. But you can see that here, if I give it a task, so I was asking it to basically get the Melbourne weather and see, could it find this for me? And the problem here is that while it can do parts of it, when it gets to doing the executor chain, its output is just not a valid tool. So it's not used to generating an output that the LangChain would be able to accept and pass to decide which tool it is. So you go into these loops of, is not a valid tool, try another one. Is not a valid tool, try another one. And eventually it will just crash. So you could play around with this. The way to fix this, and maybe we'll do this as a new video, is that you would basically make a data set of examples of what it should be like, and then you would train up, you know, you fine tune the Koala model on this, and then come back and see like, okay, could this work? So perhaps we'll look at doing that over the next week or so when I'm traveling, and then we'll put it together and sort of show how you could do it. So there's nothing stopping you doing this in regards to LangChain or the language model. It's just that these fine-tuned Llama models that we've been looking at are just not really built for doing the LangChain tasks. And they're not really big enough to have enough understanding that they can learn just with the in-context learning of how to do these tasks. So you'd probably need to fine-tune a version for that. So that's something that we can look at in the future. Anyway, as always, if you've got questions, please put them in the comments. If you found this video useful, please click like and subscribe. I will see you in the next video. Bye for now.